We light our candle to shine a light of hope for all to see. We trust that the light of Christ is present with us in this place and shines brightly in our lives and in our community of faith. Thank you, Diane. Good morning. Welcome to Ebenezer United Church on the second Sunday after Pentecost. All those who are attending in person and those on Zoom. The announcements for the week are in the bulletin and e-news. Let me highlight a few of them. Happy birthday to Brent Lamptey on June the 2nd and Glenn York, June 8th. Thanks to Margaret Tribe, Catherine Hions, Diane McLean for their leadership in today's service. Gratitude to the audiovisual team for connecting us in person and online. We are pleased to have soloist Joan Allen share her music with us this morning. Thank you. Ordering of gift cards in support of the Stephen Lewis Foundation, grandmothers to grandmothers. It runs from June 2nd to the 9th. Please order the forms. They are available in the narthex or contact Jacqueline Lovell. Ebenezer United Church is having a community yard sale on Saturday, June the 8th, rain or shine. And also the UCW mini bake sale after church on June the 16th. The rest of the announcements are in the bulletin. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Please stand as you are able for the call to worship. Let us do this responsibly. Come, faithful people, and find that quiet center where God may enter in. Gather as God's people, hungry for our holy presence, ready for God's word to us. Let us worship God. Our opening hymn this morning is Come and Find the Quiet Center. Voices United 374.
Thank you. Lord, we have come to you this day bringing all that we have, our lives, our hopes and dreams, our fears and sorrows. Open our hearts to receive your words and your spirit, that we may find healing and comfort.
Open our lives to wondrous possibilities for service and joy that you offer to us.
Ease our minds and spirits, that we may hear the words of encouragement and peace today. Amen. My friends, the God who challenges us is also the God who encourages us. The God who confronts us is also the God who accepts us. Be assured that God is with us even now, accepting, guiding, and empowering us. We are so blessed. And we are blessed to have our friend Joan here. Joan and I met a number of years ago on the curling ice, the interfaith league that Mark and I curl with and Juan Herr curls with, and those of you who know Robin Wardlaw, lovely people to spend time with and to exercise with and to grow into friends. So I'd like you to meet Joan.
Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you so much, Joan. Grace and peace from God our Creator, Jesus our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit our Sustainer be with you all. Just greet the people around you. Good morning. There's no sun outside, but there's sun in here. So when we practiced God of the Bible, it sounded like a couple people knew it. It's a lovely song. So let's do the full version, God of the Bible.
Mark and I got married here 37 years ago this month, our oldest son got married here on New Year's Eve, and three of our four children were baptized here. And our name is up there, so even if you don't know me, I kind of feel like I know you because you're part of this family. So I need to get the money. So probably driving me so crazy. I brought you a little story this morning from this book called How the Children Became Stars. But it's stories from all sorts of faith traditions, not just people like us that come to Christian church, but there's stories from Jewish families and Hindu families and Buddhist families. And the one I have for you today is called When the Cat Came to Muhammad. So it's a traditional Muslim story. Ready? The Prophet Muhammad was reading from the Quran, the holy book, to a large group of eager listeners in the desert. A sickly cat walked up to Muhammad, sat down on the hem of his very precious robe, and went to sleep. All day, the Prophet Muhammad shared talk with the believers, the sun rising to its greatest strength and falling again. It's a little bit like the story of Jesus preaching on the hill, and then because the day had been so long, they needed to feed them. It's kind of like that. The cat remained there all day long too, asleep and still, healing in the way cats do, in the protection of the Prophet Muhammad and the softness of his robe. At last, the day was coming to its end, and all, along with the Prophet, were now to return to their dwelling place for the night. Without a word, the Prophet took a knife, cut off the hem of his robe on which the sick cat lay sleeping, destroying the finest of robes, and he left the cat undisturbed. So it's a little story, but it's got kind of a big message. So just imagine this great leader in his finery, this wonderful robe, and it flows down and it spills out onto the floor, and this little cat who was feeling tired and not great just cuddled up on the robe. And at the end of the day, instead of just flicking the cat off, he cut his robe and he let the cat stay there where it felt safe. So this is what I think the message of the story is. Sometimes a little of what we have, and we all have a lot, but sometimes a little of what we have means an awful lot to somebody else. So as your family and all the families here support the outreach of the church, the food programs and everything wonderful you do, just remember that it might not be a big thing. Maybe you give up something out of the kitchen cupboard that you really like, but when you give it to somebody else, it may be a very big gift. So should we say thank you to God? Okay, let's pray just for a sec. We say, dear God, we thank you for the stories that teach us about how you want us to live in your world. Amen. Off you go. We'll see you later. Oh, the Lord's Prayer. Sorry. Will you help us lead the congregation in the Lord's Prayer? Okay. Let's say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thank you for not being shy.
listen as we pray for illumination. Your word sheds light upon our way and brings healing to our souls and gives purpose to our lives. Open our hearts and minds to hear what your Spirit is saying to us. Amen. The first scripture reading is from Luke chapter 17, verses 1 to 10. He said to his disciples, "Hard trials and temptations are bound to come, but too bad for whoever brings on. Better to wear a concrete vest and take a swim with the fishes than give even one of these dear ones, little ones, a hard time. Be alert. If you see your friend going wrong, correct him. If he responds, forgive him, even if he is personal against you and repeated seven times through the day, and seven times he says, 'I am sorry, I won't do it again,' forgive him." The apostles came up and said to the master, "Give us more faith." But the master said, "You don't need more faith. There is no more or less in faith. If you have a bare kernel of faith, say the size of a poppy seed, you could say to this sycamore tree, 'Go jump in the lake,' and it would do it. Suppose one of you has a servant who comes in from plowing the field or tending the sheep. Would you take his coat, set the stable, and say, 'Sit down and eat'? Wouldn't you be more likely to say, 'Prepare dinner, change your clothes, and wait table for me until I've finished my coffee. Then go to the kitchen and have your supper.' Does the servant get special thanks for doing what's expected of him? It's the same with you. When you've done everything expected of you, be a matter of fact and say, 'The work is done. What we were told to do, we did.'"
Thank you, Tissa. And from 1 Corinthians 12, a passage I'm sure many of you are familiar with. What I want to talk about now is the various ways God's Spirit gets worked into our lives. This is complex and often misunderstood, but I want you to be informed and knowledgeable. Remember how you were when you didn't know God, led from one phony God to another, never knowing what you were doing, just doing it because everybody else did it. It's different in this life. God wants us to use our intelligence to seek to understand as well as we can. For instance, by using your heads, you know perfectly well that the Spirit of God would never prompt anyone to say, "Jesus be damned." Nor would anyone be inclined to say, "Jesus is Master," without the insight of the Holy Spirit. God's various gifts are handed out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various ministries are carried out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various expressions of power are in action everywhere, but God Himself is behind it all. Each person is given something to do that shows who God is. Everyone gets in on it. Everyone benefits. All kinds of things are handed out by the Spirit and to all kinds of people. The variety is wonderful. Wise counsel, clear understanding, simple trust, healing the sick, miraculous acts, proclamation, distinguishing between spirits, tongues, interpretation of tongues. All these gifts have a common origin, but are handed out one by one by the one Spirit of God. He decides who gets what and when. Since I was here in the fall, you have moved through the liturgical seasons of Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Lent, Easter, and then 2 weeks ago, Pentecost. These are times when the church is very busy, busy one way or another. But now we are in what the church calls its ordinary time, the everyday time in between the feasts and grand celebrations and special services, the time when hopefully faith lives and grows and sustains, when we can take a breath and give thanks for the gifts of the Holy Spirit, for her lively scheming, and for the many opportunities that we have to follow in the footsteps of the first ones to go out in the name of Jesus. I remember years ago, many lively conversations right here at Ebenezer about the nature of discipleship. How much was too much to ask of our fellow travelers? How much was too little? And if we set down discipleship guidelines, will anyone be moved to embrace those guidelines? And if discipleship is the process of learning to love and follow Jesus and become more like him in our attitudes and actions, will some of us wonder, can't we just do that here in the safe space of like-minded Christians? I remember the discomfort felt by some, and I remember that many of us did not truly feel prepared to go out to talk about our faith and our mission. In order to prepare his disciples for their mission, Jesus talked over and over again about the life of a follower of the way. He talked about the hard parts, the cost of following him, and about dividing households. He talked about bringing not peace, but division. And in Matthew 10, he said, "Stay alert. This is hazardous work I'm assigning you. You're going to be like sheep running through a wolf pack. So don't call attention to yourselves. Be shrewd as a snake, inoffensive as a dove. Don't be naive. Some people will question your motives. Others will smear your reputation just because you believe in me." He also talked about the good parts, the work with the people, about welcoming and helping strangers, seeking lost sheep and lost coins and lost sons. He told stories, parables, like the one about the Good Samaritan and the one about the rich fool who hoards his blessings, and the one about the great banquet, where Jesus pretty much forces his listeners to consider how they have actually responded to God's call. In the reading shared with you this morning, Jesus teaches that we must forgive anyone who asks for our forgiveness, no matter how many times we have been offended. And he warns his disciples that anyone who leads his children astray, well, they will be better off to be weighed down by concrete vest and thrown in the sea. Considering his usual message of love and tolerance, we cannot be blamed for wondering just what it is that causes Jesus to be so harsh in his judgment of those who were not adherents. For now, let's just say Jesus was well aware of the opposition that his followers were going to encounter and the temptation they would feel to succumb to the community's old ways. I think he's saying, stay on course, my course, or the weight of your faithlessness will be your cross to bear. Is it any wonder that after hearing all of this, the apostles cried out, "Increase our faith, increase it, please, so that we can succeed at all of this." They know they are being asked to be living examples of God's love and forgiveness and God's yearning for justice. They are being asked to assume significant positions of leadership in this new way, and to endure not only the temptation and opposition of which I just spoke, but also the risk of being outliers. And they are instructed all the while to be humble servants, seeking no glory, no earthly reward. Is it any wonder they feel ill-equipped? But as usual, Jesus' response to their plea, and to us, because we too feel ill-equipped, is not a prescriptive one. That is, he doesn't tell them what disciplines to embrace or upon which texts to meditate in order to become more faithful. He doesn't give them self-help books. He doesn't give us guidelines for discipleship dummies. Instead, he uses yet another metaphor, that of the poppy seed. In some versions of the Bible, mustard seeds. To show his followers that even if their faith is only the size of a seed, they still can do great things. In essence, he says, you don't need more faith. There is no more or less in faith. We all know just how the disciples are feeling. Each and every one of us here has doubted or will doubt our faith and our capacity to respond in faith. Each of us has doubted that we have enough of what it takes. But doubt is not a bad thing. We should feel no guilt about this truth. As Frederick Buchner says, doubts are the ants in the pants of faith. They keep it awake and moving. It's a good one, right? It is my experience that faith is an on-again, off-again, rather than a once-and-for-all thing. Sometimes our faith is strong, vibrant, energizing, and sometimes it is just a restless stirring deep inside of us, hardly recognizable. But that simple stirring can be a wondrous thing. I want to tell you a little story, one that may resonate for some of you. I once had the privilege of knowing and respecting a wonderful woman. Like many of us, her life had not always been easy, and there was a time when she felt alone, afraid, and stripped of her faith. But she put one foot in front of another. What else do you do when you have children? And she brought her children up and she made a life for herself. Then one day, her son invited her to his church. "At least come and sing in the choir. You love to sing, Mom." And so she did. I'm going to cry. Not because she wanted to find God again, because God had let her down. She went just because she wanted to sing and make a few friends. But faith must have been stirring in her heart, just a mustard seed, a poppy seed of faith, waiting, waiting. And one day the minister simply said, "God is love." And those few words were enough. Said at the right time, in the right place, a mustard seed comment was enough. enough to make her feel open again to God's overtures, open to what God might do with her life. And what God did was wonderful. Jesus says, you do not have to increase your faith to do bigger and better things. You just need the tiniest bit of faith imaginable. A grain of seeds worth of faith can empower you to do great things for God. As Paul makes clear in his letters to the Corinthians, we do not all have the same gifts, but we have what is necessary to do the things Jesus asks of us. And all together, we should be an amazing force for love, justice, and mercy. We can trust what we have been given, trust what we have to give, because it is more than enough. You can uproot trees. You can move mountains. We can rekindle the spark in the lost and the lonely. You have, of late, been discouraged. And I understand why. Two pastoral relationships that did not blossom. Members that have not returned after COVID or who are not here for other reasons. The burden of capital expenses. The workload has been heavy for some of you, and you are to be commended for your faithfulness. I wish there was a magic wand tucked away in that storage room, but there isn't. So my message for you today is simple but heartfelt. Have hope. Trust all the wonderful seeds in your midst. Stay on course and be alert for the Holy Spirit's mysterious ways. I know we don't always feel able to do what is asked of us. Sometimes just hanging on to hope is all we can manage. So if that is the case for you, know that you can turn to the person next to you and they will have enough faith for you both. And turn to Jesus. Turn to Jesus over and over again and ask to have your faith increased. And over again, Jesus will say, I have already given you all that you need, and I will always be with you. And so we say, thanks be to God for this promise. Amen.
Our next hymn is, I Have Called You By Your Name, More Voices, 161.
Thank you.
Today, take time to prayerfully consider your abundance and how you react when someone asks you to give. As the church, we are committed to doing God's work in our community and around the world. We are invited to offer our gifts toward that end. Therefore, friends, I ask that you continue to give as you have been so faithfully giving. Our offerings will now be received.
Before the prayers of the people, I always like to invite people to share any celebrations that are ongoing in their life or coming up. We have the two birthdays. Also, Joan's birthday is this week, so happy birthday to you too. Any other celebrations?
One?
Oh, my gosh. Jake will be 2 in July. It's hard to believe. So yesterday, Mark and I went to Belleville to watch three of our five granddaughters dance in the recital. And I have to tell you, a lot of the kids were about this big. So you can imagine. It was an hour of absolute joy. And we were so lucky to have that. And I hope that you have a similar event in your life sometime soon, because the little ones are just so delightful. Well, life is full of celebrations, but it's also full of things that give us concern. I know that there are names here on your prayer list. Are there any other concerns you would like to lift up? Yes, Joan. We will pray for them as well. Any other concerns? I know we all hold a tremendous amount of concern in our hearts for the events in Ukraine and the Middle East and other places of trouble, that we know that we have brothers and sisters around the world who don't live in the kind of peace that we live in. Some are hungry, some are afraid, some have doubt about their future, and I know that we hold all of these people in our hearts. So let us just take a moment and pray. Loving and constant God, we thank you for your steadfast presence in our lives. Thank you for the people who travel with us, those who share your light, and those who help us to shine. This morning, we hear your affirmation that you have given us all we need to do your work. We thank you for that, but we acknowledge that we do not always feel your strength in us. Help us, we pray, to be more aware, less afraid. Bless us with determination and patience as we try to live into your dreams for us. We lift up to you all our celebrations and concerns, those we name out loud and those that are in our hearts. And we pray, especially this morning, for Joan's friends and family, for Bala, Michelle, Cyril, Joseph, Glenn and Ina's friends, Keith, Norman and Pat, Kay, Joyce, Tanya's friend Jenna, Mary's brother Basil and sister Kathy, and Joseph's relatives in the Ukraine. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. Our final hymn is Bless Now, O God, the Journey.
Bless now, O God, the journey that on your people laid.
Thank you for your warm welcome this morning. I hope that the coming week is kind to you and that you open yourselves up to the Holy Spirit and see all these lovely potential mustard seeds, poppy seeds around us. I ask that we bless the ministers that will be with you in the coming weeks, and I pray for nothing but good things for you. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, go in peace and go in hope. Amen.